Hello, everyone. Good morning.
Hi, teacher. Good morning.
I hope everyone's doing well today, this fine Wednesday, December 15th, 2021. Today, we begin our third day of our TOEFL English practice course. Today, we're going to focus mainly on grammar. On Monday, we focused primarily on vocabulary. I've included some information here in our website page here, so you should be able to access this information. If anyone is having some problems accessing this information, let me know. You should be able to open up the website directly within Microsoft Teams. If not, I can share the link also here in the chat. Okay, if for some reason you're not able to open up the page. Sometimes this happens to me if I go back and I just go back and click another page here within Teams and then go back to the website. Sometimes that helps. Okay, so you might try that if for some reason it doesn't load up onto your page. But Monday we talked about some vocabulary strategies and we looked at some examples. Yesterday we focused on listening comprehension. We talked about Cornell notes and how using this strategy can be helpful. Okay, when you're listening. Okay, and again, it may or may not be helpful in the moment of taking the exam, but again, try to take examples from TOEFL listening audios and just your general listening, whatever you're listening to see how the strategy works for you. Try to get used to using this strategy and give it a chance, right? Try it. And try it several times before you decide if the strategy works for you. Sometimes it takes a little bit of time to learn the strategy before we know enough to determine whether the strategy helps us or not. Okay, and this might be the case for adapting this strategy. Today I want to focus on grammar. And wow, there's all kinds of grammar structures, right? We could spend a long time talking about different grammatical structures. Unfortunately, we won't have time to really dive into all of the structures, but I have listed here in this page, if you see my screen, general categories or general types of grammatical structures that you can expect to see in the TOEFL exam. Many, if not all, of these grammatical structures might be familiar to you. Those of you who have completed PROPE probably have looked into all of these structures in great length. Now, I have some information. All of these categories, all of these structures have this down arrow. Okay, so if you're not familiar with Notion, you can click on this down arrow to open up additional information. Now you'll notice at the time of this recording, at the time of this online session, some sections have more information than others. Okay, so I will continue to add information and try to provide additional links to these different structures so you can go back periodically and access this information. All of this information I'm sharing with you in this page will be made available. It's a public page and I'll keep it out there even after the course, okay? So this might be something that you want to refer to later or simply just take note in the types of grammatical structures to perhaps search yourself online in YouTube, for example, these different grammatical structures, okay? Whatever works for you, but I think it's helpful as we start to look today at some examples of grammatical questions, to start to think about the category, the type of question that they are including. What are they testing you on? And so as you become more familiar with these items in TOEFL, these grammar items, you'll start to see patterns. You'll start to see these grammatical structures come up over and over. All right, so also at the top, I have the recording from Monday and Tuesday. That's what you see here, these two videos. I think both of these have been trimmed down and edited. So I think I removed the time where there's no speaking. And also the listening, I did not include the TOEFL since that's, I can't really share that publicly. But you might access this if for some reason you missed one of the classes, or simply if you just need to review something. All right, so today we're going to focus, my friends, on grammar. And today we're going to use OneNote. Okay, this is OneNote up here at the top where it says PLC Notebook. So if you're on a cell phone, you're also going to need the app, the OneNote app installed in order to view this information. If that's a problem, or if you just don't want to install that app and you just want to look at my screen, great, no problem. If you're on a PC or a laptop, it's going to, I think, be a little bit easier to see or access this information, okay? But you can also look at my screen. All right, so today what I wanted to do is first share with you some general sentence patterns. We'll talk about this. And then I have a space, a page here called Grammar Examples, and we'll be looking at some things. I'll be writing things down here and sharing some ideas with you as we look specifically at some of the grammar items. Now, I want to talk with you guys and work with you this first hour, okay, looking at some examples. And then at 11 o'clock, we're going to have two practice reviews or two grammar structure reviews, however you want to call it. So maybe I should tell you this first. At 11 o'clock from 11 to 11:30, we will access our first TOEFL grammar review. This is the grammar review number one. If you click on this link, and feel free to go ahead and do so, this will take you to the grammar review. Now, it's not available yet. It will be available today from 11 a.m. to 11:30. And the second TOEFL grammar review will be available from 11:30 to 12. All right, so you basically have 25 minutes, actually 30 minutes to complete it, but the exam will give you, will have 25 minutes to complete the, I think, 40 items that are included, okay? But I'll give you 30 minutes. Just make sure that you submit before the deadline. In this case, 11:30 for the first and 12 p.m. for the second, okay? So just to give you a heads up, these are the two links that we'll be using today from 11 to 12, giving us some practice opportunities, answering some grammar questions. All right. So let's go back to our OneNote, our personal learning community. I think that's what that stands for, PLC. And I want to talk first about sentence patterns, because I think anytime you look at a grammar item, what helps me when I look at these and I'm trying to come up with the right answer, this is the first thing that I always think about. This is the first thing that I do. And those of you who have had me in a grammar class before, where I've done some diagramming of sentences, okay, this will sound familiar. Now, we're not going to get into all the specifics. Don't worry about if you don't understand diagramming sentences. But what I want to share with you here today are some very common sentence patterns in the English language. The first being subject verb. This is probably one of the most basic sentences that you could develop in the English language. Tom sings, right? Tom sings. We have a subject, Tom, and we have a verb. Okay, this is a very common pattern. In the English language, we always need a subject and we always need a verb. Okay, when you're looking at these grammar structures in the TOEFL exam, you need to find the subject. You need to find the verb. This is very important. This is the first thing that I do when I look at anything so I understand, you know, what the main structure. Okay, this will help. We have also another very common sentence pattern, subject, verb, and a direct object. Tom sings songs. Okay, so we have songs as a noun, functioning as a direct object of the verb, and so on. Subject, verb, direct object. We also have subject, and we have a linking verb, and a noun. Tom is a doctor. Tom, subject, is, linking verb, doctor, right, is a noun. We call this a predicate noun because it's in the predicate. It's after the verb. Tom is tall. Subject, linking verb, predicate, adjective. Tom threw the ball to Lucy. Tom's the subject, verb, throw, or threw in the past tense. Ball's the direct object. To whom did Tom throw the ball? To Lucy is the indirect object. So we have subject, verb, direct object, indirect object. And yes, we can say Tom threw Lucy the ball. We can change the order, but we still have this common sentence pattern. Subject, verb, direct object, indirect object. Now, there are other patterns, but I just want to give you an overview. This is what we're looking for. We're trying to find the main clause, trying to find the subject and the verb. This is really the safest place to begin before you answer any of the questions. And the faster that you can do this, the quicker that you can recognize these patterns from the examples, I think the better chance you're going to have to figure out what's wrong with the sentence, because that's really what we're doing. We're trying to find out what fits, what's incorrect in the sentence. And a lot of times if we start here, everything else will fall into place. It'll be easier to detect the error. All right, so let's take a look. I'm going to give you an example. Now, here in the examples, I'm going to be, let's see, what would be the easiest way? I think what I'll do is I'll copy and paste here in the notebook the examples. Okay, and I was going to copy and paste in the chat, but I think this will be easier. So let's try this, see how it goes. All right, so here's our first example. Now, our examples here are going to include omissions, okay, spaces where we're going to need to insert the correct word. Now, as you know, all of you are familiar with the TOEFL exam. You know that you'll be given four options. But for the purposes of our analysis, one of the first things I want us to try to do here is to find the subject and the verb. All right, now here I have two lines. All right, again, this section here is going to be our subject and this is going to be our verb. Now, we don't know yet if there's a direct object or anything else, but at this point, this is our first place we need to start. So my question to you is, what is our subject of this example? What do you think? And let's go straight to the main clause of the sentence. And go ahead and activate your mic, guys, because I'm not going to be able to see if you're posting anything in the chat. I'm sorry, I don't know if I'll be able to keep up with the chat. So feel free to turn on your mics. What do you think the subject of this sentence is in the main clause?
Teacher, in my case, I can barely see the letters. I don't know if it's just me, but they are very small.
Okay. All right. I think this is Kato, right? Kato, can you open up the OneNote on your computer, or do you have access to a computer?
No, I will change it in a while because I've been having trouble. Yes.
Okay. Let me try to make this bigger here. Okay. Does this help, guys? Let me do 16. Is that any better?
Yeah, it is much better. Thank you.
Okay. All right. You're welcome. Okay. So what do you guys think? What's the subject? If you had to choose one word, what's the subject of the main clause in this example?
Maybe a passport?
Mm-hmm. That's right. Passport. Okay. Yes, and technically it could be the phrase a passport, but yes, passport is going to be our subject. Now, what is the verb of the subject in the main clause?
Is.
So we have a linking verb. All right, now, this is our start. This is where we need to be able to recognize instantly. What's the subject? Well, first of all, what's the main clause? Okay. Because in this case, we have, with a few exceptions, we have a passport is or is required. Then we have a word here that we need to add and so on. All right. So we have a passport and we have this, the verb is. What is with a few exceptions? Feel free to jump in, guys. This is, if you want to keep your microphones on, if you don't have a lot of background noise, feel free to do so. What do you think? What
like
is?
Like an introductory phrase?
It is. It is an introductory phrase. What kind of introductory phrase is this, with a few exceptions?
Prepositional phrase.
That's right. So we have prepositional phrase. Prepositional phrase. Now, prepositional phrases are extra information, right? It's like icing on the cake. We don't need prepositional phrases, right? We can remove them. We don't need them. We do need a subject. We do need a verb. In this case, we have a passport. Is required. Okay, required is going to be our adjective. Okay, so we have something like one of our sentence patterns here would be like this, an adjective. Now, the question I have for you is, what word do you think we could add here? I'll give you some options, but before I give you the options, what do you think could be added here after the word required? Any ideas?
Maybe for all US citizens.
Four. Okay. Anybody else have some thoughts?
The preposition to.
Okay. We have four. We have two. Let me give you the options here that you might see on a TOEFL. Now, what are they testing? Before we figure out which preposition we need here, well, I guess I just told you. What are we looking for? What kind of item is this? This is related to prepositional phrases, okay? So you're going to see a lot of questions like this that are testing your understanding of prepositions. So in this case, a passport is required. What do you think the best answer is? Again, I don't have the chat here, so just jump in. And it doesn't matter if you make a mistake. Don't worry about it. What do you think now that you see the options? Don't be shy. To, with, of, or at. To all U.S. citizens, with all U.S. citizens, of all U.S. citizens, or at all U.S. citizens.
Two.
Two. Anybody else? Okay, the answer actually is of, okay, is required of all U.S. citizens, okay? Prepositions are really difficult in English, right? But what I want to show you here is, in this case, we have of all U.S. citizens is our prepositional phrase. And then who depart and enter, okay? This is a relative clause. It's an adjective clause. Now, this is what, when you guys are looking at examples, and I highly suggest that you go online. You can find examples pretty much anywhere. It's fairly easy to find some examples of TOEFL questions, and you don't need a lot. You don't need to find tons and tons of examples. But go and just look at any example of a TOEFL, of a question, of a grammar question, and do what we're doing here. Find the subject, find the verb, find the prepositional phrases, if there are any, and find any clauses, relative clauses, and subordinating clauses. And again, let me pull up here. I'm looking at these structures, okay? The question is, can you identify adjective clauses, adverb clauses, and noun clauses? Can you find prepositional phrases, okay? These are the main things. I think this is where I would always begin. Can you find the clauses? Can you find the prepositional phrases? That's where I would begin. If you can do that, if you can identify the prepositional phrases and the clauses, it's going to help you a lot, okay? Now, when I say phrases, prepositional phrases, I'm also including noun phrases and verb phrases, okay? So can you identify the phrases and the clauses of a sentence? Okay, let's look at another example. All right, here is a second example. Let me increase this. Okay, hopefully you can see this. Now, right away, what's the subject in the verb of the main clause? If you had to choose one word, what would be, we call this the head noun, what's the subject, but what's the noun, the one word, the single word that is the main subject of the sentence?
I would say migration.
Okay. The first large scale, those are all adjectives. It's an article and adjectives, okay? We don't need it. Migration. The migration, if you want to say it like that. We're going to simplify this sentence. Now, what's from the old world? What's from the old world? What do you think? Let's give some colors here. So we got green is our subject. Passport is our subject. Now, what is from the old world? What kind of grammatical structure do you think that is?
Prepositional phrase.
That's right. And we have also to the something. All right. Now we have a blank. And we have during. So what do you think during the last ice age is? What kind of grammatical structure is during the last ice age?
Maybe an adverb?
It is functioning as an adverb, but what kind of grammatical structure? Now, when I say grammatical structure, I'm kind of referring to basically thinking in terms of clauses and phrases, okay? Clauses and phrases. Is during the last ice age a phrase or a clause? And if which kind would it be?
Could it be an adverbial phrase?
All right, so adverbial phrase, okay. It is an adverbial phrase, but what kind of, it's functioning as an adverb, but what kind of phrase is it? It's actually a prepositional phrase, okay? But yes, it is, it's functioning as an adverb. We know that prepositional phrases can function as adjectives. They're just like big adjectives, or they can be big adverbs. Okay, that's how they function. But in this case, we just have another prepositional phrase. You don't even need to know necessarily that it's an adverb. Just recognize this as a prepositional phrase. Now, what is around 11,500 years ago? Prepositional phrase. So, my friends in English, go online, find your favorite list of prepositions. I'm a big fan of lists. Those of you who have had me before, I sound like a broken record. I love lists. If I can give you any advice on grammatical structures, I would have a list of prepositions. Again, and if you don't like the one I'm showing here, just do a search, list of prepositions in English, and you're going to get all kinds of options. But find one that you like, that is helpful, save it. Save it on your phone. Print it out. Create, if you don't have one already, a portfolio of grammatical structures and put that into your portfolio. Have a list of subordinating conjunctions. We'll look at those later. Subordinating conjunctions, a list of prepositional phrases, and a list of regular and irregular verbs in the present, past, and past participle. That would be my suggestion, the main lists that will help you, I think, greatly. If you're not sure, right, if it's taking some time to know or identify these, all right? Now notice here, we've got how many prepositional phrases? One, we actually have two, three, four prepositional phrases here. We have one here, just one. Actually two of all the citizens. Right away, we're seeing that prepositional phrases are going to be in probably every grammatical structure. Now, the question may or may not be related to prepositions, but you need to know what these are because usually it helps to ignore them. It's like, I want you to recognize them and then in many cases, ignore them. Why? Why do I say that? Because in this example, we need to fill out a word here. And let me give you the options. We need to fill in the word after the word new. And here are our options. In fact, I'm just going to type the option. Well, no, I'm not. Okay. So here are the options. Oy. Okay. Just forget the highlighting. I'll remove that in a minute. And it shouldn't be capitalized. Lowercase. So what do you think? Now, before we answer the question, my question to you is, what are we testing? What are they testing? What do they want you to know in this example? What do we have to add here? What's missing?
The verb tense.
That's right. The verb phrase. That's exactly right. The verb phrase. Okay. So here I'm just going to put verb phrase. They want to know if you can recognize the correct verb tense, right? Or just the verb phrase or the verb tense. So my question to you is, which do you think is correct? Have been, happening, happened, happening, was, happened. Any ideas?
I may say happened.
Happened. The migration happened around 11,500 years ago. Notice what I just did. I ignored many of the prepositions. All right. All we need to do here, guys, is say, migration happened. Let me add here. This is all we need to figure out. The migration happened. When did it happen? Oh, around 11,500 years ago, or during the last ice age. The migration happened during the last ice age. Notice how this is the mental note that I look at when I see this example. I'm not concerned about the first large scale. I'm not concerned about from the old world to the new. I don't need it. All I need is the migration happened. It happened. You know, you've heard the expression, shit happens. That's a complete sentence. We've got a subject and we've got a verb. Guess what? The migration happened. That's all we need to know. All this other stuff, all these other phrases, they're distractors. That's what they do. They try to distract you so that you have a hard time recognizing what the correct verb is in this case. All right, that's what's going on here. That's why the quicker that you can identify the subject and the verb and if you can recognize quickly the phrases and the clauses, primarily the prepositional phrases, okay, this is going to help you. Going to help you big time. Look at another example. Okay, we'll move this down. Increase this a bit. All right. Now, very quickly, what's the subject? Let's jump right in.
Distinction.
Easy peasy, twice as cheesy. Distinction. Now, what's the verb of the subject? Because remember, if we have a subject, we have to have a verb someplace. So, do we have a subject? I'm sorry, do we have a verb? And if it is, what is it?
Was.
I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
Was.
Okay, this is our sentence pattern. Subject, verb, linking verb, adjective. Okay, this is one of our common sentence patterns. The distinction was not obvious. All right, now that's our main clause. Now we can start to see what's missing. The distinction, blank, all right, was not obvious. So what do you think we need here, even whether you know the word itself, but what kind of word do you think we're going to need? I can write out the options, but what do you think? What kind of words am I typing out here as options?
Preposition.
That's right. Are you guys seeing a pattern here? They want to know, do you know which preposition to use? Now, my question to you is, do you know which preposition to use? What do you think? From, among, with, between.
Between.
Ding, 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 ding. You are correct. I want to know the difference between inanimate and inanimate objects. I want to know the difference between football, American football, and soccer. I want to know the difference between these two things. Okay. This is a preposition, the prepositional phrase, between animate and inanimate objects. This is our prepositional phrase. Notice again, too early man. What's this? Prepositional phrase. Are you seeing a pattern? A lot of prepositional phrases, whether it's in the question itself or whether it's just a distractor like this. They want to know if you can find them. The sooner you can find them and then remove them, in a lot of cases, the better. In this case, we see right away, we need to know which of these prepositions are going to work for us, right? Which one do we need? Next one. Okay, so what's the first thing we need to do? Subject and verb. What's our subject?
Candidate.
That's right. What's the verb? If we have it, do we know it?
Receive.
That's right. Now, a candidate must receive something, all right? And this is what they're looking for. What do we need here? So let's look at some options. Okay, now these options, if I can move this down just a bit. Here are our options. Just ignore the capitalization, should be all lowercase. Sorry, this is wrong. Now, before we answer this question, what is it checking? What are they trying to check your understanding of in this example? Look at these options here. What do you notice? What's the difference?
Maybe the place of the preposition?
The place of the preposition, okay. Anyone else have another way of stating this? I mean, it is the place of the preposition. I guess what I was looking for also is the word order, the overall word order, okay? Which also includes the order of the preposition, but it could also include the order of everything else that comes after the preposition. So this is an example. You'll see some items like this that just checks to see if you know the correct order of the words. Now, in this case, it does happen to be a preposition. What do you think the correct option is? And I could ask another question. What could I put here in our analysis? Okay, this is a little messy. Let me see if I can clean this up. What would you put here after receive in our diagram? This would probably be a direct object. Go ahead. What do you think?
Note.
Okay, a candidate must receive what? What should the candidate receive? We need a direct object for the verb receive. Anybody else? Receive what? Even before we try to answer this, can we ask, if we ask the question, the candidate or a candidate must receive what? How would you answer that question?
Notes.
All right, this is a little tricky. It's actually a number. Okay, must receive a number. Now, it must receive a number. It must receive a greater number of notes. Okay, so our correct answer in this case is this. Okay, this is going to be our correct answer, a greater number of. So a candidate must receive a number, what kind of number? A number of notes. Of notes is going to be a prepositional phrase, of notes. Describing number, what kind of number? Well, the number of notes. Okay, so when you see these, the first thing, subject and a verb, then ask yourself, okay, if there is a direct object, ask yourself what? To receive what? To throw what? To study what? Okay, whatever the verb is, ask yourself the question, the what question, to help determine what the direct object of that verb happens to be. And in this case, I think it helps to ask that question, receive what? Receive a number. What kind of number? A number of notes. Okay, a greater number of notes. Now, greater is just, yeah, we can get into that. That's an adjective. It's a or a quantifier, okay? A greater number, greater than, greater number of notes than, okay? So it's testing greater than. Okay, let's look at another one. Again, we need the subject and the verb of the main clause. What do you think?
Advances is the subject.
And the verb?
Have been.
Okay, this is our verb phrase. Okay, anytime we think of a verb, also think of a verb phrase, even if it's just one word. Okay, always think of it as a verb phrase because, well, as we know, we have some verbs that are more than one word. So we have our subject and then we have our verb phrase. Now, here are our options. Let me again move this down. I have a hard time spacing this appropriately. Let's bring this bad boy down just a bit. Okay, so here are our options. Again, ignore the capitalization, just capitalizes automatically. We're looking for some kind of adjective or quantifier or determiner, whatever you want to call it, but something that's going to describe the word person or it relates to the noun person. So what do you think?
I think the answer is one.
That's right. Now, in this case, have been the work of only, this is, I think, a hint. And obviously, person, is person singular or plural?
Singular.
Okay, so this is also an indicator, all right? So we're looking for agreement between this adjective and the noun, okay? Or it could be checking your understanding of agreement with quantifiers. Okay, so these two would be more appropriate for plurals, right? Plural nouns, right? Some apples or non-countable nouns. Do you have any time? Do you have some time? So non-countable nouns, plurals, that's when we want to use these quantifiers. One, in this case, an adjective, one person. Okay, now again, in this case, maybe this wasn't overly helpful. Okay, maybe you didn't need to know what the subject and the verb is, but again, the quicker that you can look and recognize the subject and the verb, I think the better off you'll be, so you can direct your attention to where you need to direct your attention. All right, let's look at another one. What's the subject? What's the verb?
The subject is foods.
And the verb?
Have.
Okay. What kind of sentence do we have here? Simple, compound, or complex?
Compound.
Okay. If you need to review the differences between a simple, compound, and complex sentence, this also, I think, is worth reviewing. So here, a compound sentence, we have two main clauses. We know that a compound sentence, requires what kind of connector?
A coordinating conjunction.
A coordinating conjunction or famboise. That's right. So we have here. Actually, two main clauses. So we have to do this. We've got a subject and a verb here, and we have a second main clause, and we need a subject and a verb. Now, what do we have missing here, and what do we have available to us to complete this second subject verb connection here or combination? What do you think? Can we fill out anything down here in terms of a subject or a verb of the second clause?
I think the subject is missing.
That's right.
This verb.
That's correct. So we need to, oops, sorry guys. Try and get rid of that. Okay, I got some technical glitches here on my iPad. All right, so provides is going to be our verb. And we need to be able to find the subject. Subject. So here are our options. Let me type those in. Before you answer, ask yourself, what are they testing? What are they testing? Looking at these four options. Single, no food, no single food, food, no single, no food, single. What are they testing?
Word order.
Word order. That's right. So the question is, what's the correct order of the words that we need for this example?
No single.
All right, so what word do I need to put down here as the subject?
Food.
Food. Piece of cake. For that. There we go. No single food. No single food. All right, I think we have time for one more. What's the subject? What's the verb?
Leaders is the verb.
Leaders.
Okay, and what's the verb?
Agreed.
All right, now this one, let me give you the options because it's hard to tell what they're testing just by looking at this. Let me move this bit down just a bit. Here are our options. Ask yourself first, what are they testing? What are they testing here in this example? This is a new one. What do you think? What do you think? What grammatical structure do you think that they are testing? We had to look at this list here of grammatical structures. What do you think? Gerunds and infinitives. This is also an area that can be very difficult for you, okay? Knowing whether or not we need to use a gerund or an infinitive. In this case, what do you think the correct answer is?
I would say to exchange.
That's right, to exchange. Now, what is to exchange and what is exchanging? Which is which?
Can you repeat the question?
What is to exchange and what is exchanging? If they're testing for gerunds and infinitives, which is which?
Oh, exchanging is the gerund and the other one is infinitive.
Right. All right, guys. So again, grammar, we could go on and on and on looking and discussing these, but notice what we're doing here. I think if you can begin by, number one, identifying the subject and the verb first, and then number two, identify quickly phrases and clauses, main clauses, subordinating clauses, relative clauses, and noun clauses, okay? Phrases, primarily prepositional phrases, but also it could be gerund phrases, participial phrases, right? But you don't necessarily need to know the type right off the bat, okay, the type of phrase. As we've seen here, look at all of the examples of prepositional phrases. Okay, they pop up all over the place. I forget the color. Did we use green? Yeah, or blue. Okay. So prepositional phrases, they're all over the place, right? This is what I want to draw your attention to, that how common prepositional phrases are. And we've seen a lot advances in science. Okay, it's another prepositional phrase. Have been the work of only. This is another prepositional phrase. I will leave that as it is. Against him or her, this is another prepositional phrase. Okay, so we've seen a lot of examples of prepositional phrases. All right, guys, it's 11:01. I want to give you time now to begin the first of two grammar practices. Remember, the first you have until 11:30 to complete. Go right into the next. All right, we won't break unless you have a question. Just jump in, and when you finish, just come back briefly. I'll have a couple of closing remarks to close for today, and this is what we'll do for the rest of today in our online session. Okay, guys, so go ahead and open up the link, and I will also include the link if for some reason you're not able to access it here from this page. I'll include it in the chat. Okay, so I'll go ahead and mute my mic, guys. Jump in if you have any questions or issues accessing these online forms. All right, everyone, it is 12 p.m. And just a few final thoughts as we close for today. I have shared the results of today's practice, the first and second practice. If you're interested to see the group results, you can access this information in the website here that I have within Microsoft Teams. Take a look at the results. Also, take a look at the results from the second review. Here's a second PDF file that you should be able to open. All of this is under the grammar, structure, and writing, a written expression section. Take a look at that. Also, I want to make sure that all of you have access to not only your final score, but also you're able to see which items you missed. Okay, so again, can everyone see which items that you missed from both of these grammar reviews?
Yes, we can.
Okay. So I think tomorrow what I'd like to do is take some of the items that maybe have a lower percentage correct, and we can take a look at those as a group. Tomorrow I want to give you some additional practice. We'll do tomorrow's session will be very similar to today's session. The first hour we'll look at some specific items, but again, I'll take items that score kind of low on the percentage correct, and then we'll spend the second hour with additional practice looking at more items for grammar. I think we there are some specific grammar structures that I think need to be explained. Okay, so I think we'll do that tomorrow as well. All right, guys, I think we'll stop there for today. And enjoy the rest of your day, and we'll talk to you tomorrow. Bye, guys.
Thank you.
Bye-bye, man. Thank you.
Bye, teacher. Thank you.